taa na kanzu shaya kata gyu lame shum digi ene liu nga tsam yuwa jamshi re.
The text that I'll be explaining today is called The Furthest Everlasting Stream, Gyu Lama, and this is a text in five chapters.
Tate ene satati ene lhele ru chabe ina chi nima gorong chi tunja chigni ru guaya re.
If I were to explain this slowly in a relaxed manner, it would take 1 or 2 weeks.
But you see, today we have to finish within 8 hours. So, and that also, you see, divided half Tibetan, half translation, isn't it? So actually only 4. So you see, impossible to explain complete 5 chapters. So I am going to explain only the first part, which is something most important part.
And also there will be opportunity for people to ask questions at the end of each session. You should write down if you have questions, you should write them down, and these will be collected, and then at the beginning of the session after that, some of them will be answered.
This one. 当然了，怎么的地方里呀？他出了蒙古去啊的，第一次他们老念那么句，他大话的些，哎，他说的，那么句大话，我说解释一下嘛，新鲜。I think I will explain. You see, in my own poor English. Now, you see, as you know, in this world. There are quite a number of different religions, but all those major religions, each have, you see, a special quality, and as a result, for certain people, for certain religion is more effective, on certain people, you see, some other religion, more, you see, effective. In any case, you see, all religion aiming, more or less same goal. So now, in this, I think, is modern period, despite many great material development, despite that, you see, still, we human being need some kind of internal progress or internal peace or spiritual experience. That is something still very important. Under that circumstances, you see, the unity between various different religions is something extremely important. And now today, I'm really happy, you see, to explain some kind of, I don't know how to say, explain Buddhist teaching in a Christian church, Christian temple. That is something marvelous, isn't it? It itself, you see, showing that now this period, you see, we have much close understanding and much close, you see, feeling. This is something very positive significance. So now, you see, now regarding Buddhism, now you know, you see, Buddha Shakyamuni, although there are some different, how to say, calculations for certain scholar, according certain scholar, since Buddha Shakyamuni come is more than 3,000 years. According to some scholars, says 2,000, more than 2,800. But generally, now we accept more than 2,500 years. Any kuzimeli, any kyadojnali, and was all sangive and zeva zeva di, any sangive and zeva, some to sangive, than zeva mamadil ziche, dimenche, any sangye pavache, to see anybody.
Then the Buddha Shakyamuni came to this grace, this earth with his presence, and then attained enlightenment. Now, according to, and once attaining enlightenment, the state of clear evolvement, then did various enlightening deeds for the benefit of everyone. Now there are different presentations of the 12 enlightening deeds of the Buddhas, of the Buddha, according to the presentation in the Hinayana text, the modest-minded vehicle text. The Buddha himself, in the earlier part of his life, was a sentient being, that's a being with limited mind, limited awareness. And then in the latter part of his life, after he achieved enlightenment, then he was an enlightened being, totally clear-minded and fully evolved. According to the vast-minded vehicle or Mahayana texts, there's the presentation of the three bodies or corpuses, or sometimes four corpuses of an enlightened being. And among these, we have the Nirmanakaya, or emanation body, or corpus of emanations. And within those, then the Buddha Shakyamuni would be included as a supreme emanation. And so throughout many lifetimes in the past, the Buddha was someone who, as an enlightened being, demonstrated over and again the various enlightening deeds. Now, although there are these various presentations of manner in which the Buddha Shakyamuni came, there can be an entire discussion as to whether or not there is the valid existence of the Mahayana path as a method for achieving the enlightened state of a Buddha. This is a discussion which is found in the Precious Garland. It's a text by Nagarjuna. And in the discussion concerning this, it's in terms of if there is the enlightened state of a Buddha, and there are only the paths of the arhats, the paths that are for the shravakas, the listeners, and the pratyeka Buddhas, the self-evolving beings, then it would be very difficult to establish the attainment of enlightenment based on only the existence of those paths. So one has to think in terms of the fact that if there are various paths which have been indicated, then they must have various results towards which they are leading. So thinking in this manner in terms of the results of the practices that the Buddha himself taught, and likewise the paths that must exist in order to achieve these various results, then one can establish the existence of the Mahayana paths as a way for achieving enlightenment. If one doesn't accept the existence of the Mahayana paths as valid paths, then it's very difficult to accept Buddhahood. That Buddhahood exists.
Yeah, yeah.
There's the presentation of how the Buddha himself came and taught. This is well known in terms of the Hinayana texts. And then in terms of various disciples that the Buddha initially taught the Hinayana teachings, but then in terms of there being various pure disciples, then he taught the Mahayana. In terms of, again, various disciples, then for some disciples who were especially pure, then by the force of their prayers, the force of prior prayers and so forth, then there's the teaching of the Tantrayana vehicle. And there's no necessity that all of these have to necessarily have been taught at the time when the Buddha himself was actually gracing this earth. And according to the accounts from the Mahayana texts, then the Buddha himself, after he demonstrated his attainment of enlightenment, then set flow three rounds of transmission of the preventive measures of the Dharma. And in the first turning of the wheel, or the first round of transmission at the Deer Park in Sarnath, the Buddha taught the Four Noble Truths, the facts that are seen as true by the highly realized. And in the second round of transmission at Vulture's Peak, the Buddha taught the perfection of wisdom sutras in terms of the demonstration of the teachings concerning reality, that there's no true existence. And then at Vaishali, the Buddha set flow the third or final round of transmission of his teachings. Buddha set flow these three rounds of transmission, and these were given in turn gradually, one after the other.
To
Tibet.
Just it. Yeah. Hmm. Did you just do something? Did you just do something? Just do something. Oh, that's better. You could see each other better. These two persons as my mouth, so I have to have closer feeling, isn't it?
So all three rounds of transmission of the teachings were gradually in turn brought to Tibet. And in Tibet, the flourishing of the teachings occurred during two periods. There's the older period, or the ancient period, of the Nyingma transmission, and then there's the later, or Sarma, transmission of the teachings.
Mm-hmm. Das sarma leya ini sakya gaju kadam sumche.
Now within the sarma, or the new transmission period, there's the transmission of the lines of the sakya, the kagyu, and the kadampa.
Ta kadam leya kadam ta jermishi majun khombo du kadam nyingma sash segyare jermishi chungsare cheleya ini kadam sarma slavare.
And within this Kadam tradition, then the period of time before Jay Rinpoche, that's Tsongkhapa, is the old Kadam tradition, and the teachings after Jay Rinpoche, Jay Tsongkhapa, are the Gelupa or Ganden teachings. Now, the situation of the teachings of the Buddha in Tibet is one in which there is a complete preservation and presentation of all the teachings of the Buddha, both the modest-minded or Hinayana, the vast-minded or Mahayana, and also the Tantra teachings. And within the Tantra teachings, there's the presentation of all four classes of Tantra, and particularly in Tibet, an extremely extensive preservation of the highest class of Tantra, the peerlessly integrated deity practice of Anuttara Yoga. In terms of the method side, or the behavior side, there's the division of within the teachings of the two vehicles, the modest-minded or Hinayana, and the vast-minded and Mahayana, or Mahayana. And also from the point of view of the view or outlook in terms of the various schools of tenets, there's a division of four. These are the schools of tenets of the Vaibhashikas, the Sautrantikas, the Chittimatrins, and the Madhyamikas. Within these tenet systems, the first two, the Vaibhashika and Sautrantika, are within the fold of the Hinayana, whereas the second two, the Chittimatran and the Madhyamaka, are both Mahayana schools. Now, it is possible for a person themselves to be a Hinayana person, but accept Mahayana tenets, and likewise could be a Mahayana person who accepts Hinayana tenets. It can work both ways. In Tibet, most of the great major texts of these four schools of tenets have been translated. Within these various schools of tenets, there are many subdivisions. In terms of the Nyingma, or the ancient tradition teachings, when we look at this our text here, Gyulama, the furthest everlasting stream, this does have a connection in terms of the Nyingma teachings of things being pure from the top or the start, and the presentation of the spontaneous accomplishment of everything. And there's also a connection of this furthest everlasting stream teachings with the Kagyu presentation of the great sealing nature of Mahamudra. And in the Sakya teachings of the paths and its results, there's also a connection here with this furthest everlasting stream teachings in their presentation, in which they present the three appearances in terms of the path and the three everlasting streams in terms of the result, and specifically within those three everlasting streams, the causal everlasting stream of the foundation of everything. In terms of that, there is a connection with this furthest everlasting stream of Gyulama. And in the Gelupa presentation of inseparable voidness and blissful awareness, particularly in terms of the discussion of primordial consciousness, there's also a connection here with this furthest everlasting stream. And so for all four of the Tibetan traditions, the main point towards which this text is in terms of the four traditions of Tibet, within Tibetan Buddhism, the ultimate view of reality is pointing primarily in terms of the discussion of how it's presented in Nuttara Yoga Tantra. Now, when we speak of this specific text of the furthest everlasting stream within the division between sutra and tantra, it falls into the category of a sutra teaching. Although various learned masters have their own individual ways of explaining this with their own characteristics, nevertheless, when we divide the teachings into the categories of sutra and tantra, the only way that this can really be explained is in terms of it being a sutra teaching. So when we ask what type of relation or connection it can have then with the tantra, then since the ultimate point, the deepest point towards which the teachings are aiming or are being directed is towards the presentation as found in a Nuttara Yoga Tantra, then we can say that this is the deepest basis from which these teachings are derived and at which they are aiming. This is the way then in which it's related. Now, in Tibet, through the line of Yumu Mikyu Dorje and then through Dolpupa, there's within the Chonang tradition the view of other voidness or other absence. And within Tibet, we find that in all four traditions, the Sakya, Kagyu, Nyingma, and Galupa, most of them give refutations and do not accept this position. However, there are those who have achieved meditative experiences and realizations and insights based on that view. Now, in terms of the division between the actual enlightening words of the Buddha himself and then the various texts which were written later, the indicative texts, this would be one of the indicative texts that came later. However, if we ask what is the source within the enlightening words of the Buddha from which this derives, it would be the sutra or exposition on the theme of the sexual factors for accordant progress. That's the Tathagata Garbha Sutra. And this sutra an exposition on the theme of the essential factors for accordant progress has been translated into Tibetan. The contents of this sutra are the same as the contents which are found in the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras.
Mm-hmm.
The first one was the essence of the Buddha Nature Sutra, and the second one is similar to what's found in the
First one, actually, there are two sutras which have similar names here. The first.
Not similar. You see. That means the chick, the Tishin Sheba, Sati, Tatagata, Tatagata Sindaya, Tatagata, Tatagata Garba in a chick. Tishin Sheba in Imbundos. Just what? She would be Sugata Sindaya. Sugata, the chick. Chick the Tatagata, chick the Sugata, the Kedwa.
So the second sutra is the Sugata Garba Sutra. And this sutra is referred in the Lankavasara Sutra as being a sutra of which requires interpretation, provisional teaching. And this teaching teaches the Tathagatagarbha as being permanent and independent reality. So this sutra is provisional, but this sutra has not been translated into Tibetan. While the first sutra, the Tathagatagarbha Sutra, was translated in Tibetan. So we have here two sutras.
This one, that is it. That D and that D Shasha Sayan Do, that D Shasha Sayan Do, Tishisha Vinibu Dosari, Nedum Dorsia.
The first one was a definitive.
The first sutra, however, the Tathagatagarbha Sutra itself, the one on the essential factors for achieving enlightenment, it's the Buddha Nature Sutra, is a definitive level sutra. The contents of those two sutras in terms of the second, the middle turning of the Wheel of Dharma, in terms of the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras, and then here the Buddha Nature Sutra, this Tathagatagarbha Sutra, were the same. Then, since there's a danger of there being of it being repetitious, then because of that, then there's the composing of this text.
Just one. Yeah.
Now, according to one group of scholars, then among these five texts, the text called a filigree of expositions on vast vehicles themes, that's the Mahayana Sutra Alankara, and then the differentiating the middle from the extremes, that's the Madhyanta Vibhanga, and the differentiating phenomenon and their actual nature, that's Dharma, Dharmata, Vibhanga, these three texts are presenting the outlook or the view of the Chittamatran schools, and so it doesn't give the ultimate view. Whereas the other two of these five, the filigree of realizations, that's Abhisamaya Alankara, and our text here, the furthest everlasting stream, or Uttara Tantra, these are presenting the ultimate Madhyamaka view, and so specifically this furthest everlasting stream is presenting the Prasangika view, and that also is what is directly... And that would also then be the deepest intention of the filigree of realizations, the Abhisamaya Alankara, as well. According to another group of interpreters, they say that of interpretation, their presentation is that the two texts, the furthest everlasting stream, the Sutra Tantra, and also this differentiating phenomenon and their actual nature, the Dharma Dharmata Vibhanga, that these two texts go together as having the same intention, and that these are extremely profound and subtle texts, and therefore they were not initially taught in a very widespread and well-known manner, but rather were hidden as treasure texts, and then later were recovered and made widespread by Maitripa.
Ah, yeah. This one. That little bit, any shundi, dan shundi, any changing gun, a perlia, a changing gun, yebe tane, ne shusati, gang decision zitamakunishi, kunua, decision zitamakunishi.
So this text came through its various transmissions into Tibet, and I myself have received the transmission of this text from Gen Rinzen Denpa, Lama from Kunu. The name of this text is a composition to indicate a vast vehicle of the mind, the furthest everlasting stream.
Mahayana Sutra Tantra Shastra Pyogyado Tekwa Chenpo Gyu Lame Tenju Shen Da Tenju Tsen Gyagyada Pyogyani Bu Diche.
Starts with the presentation of the name in the Indian language, Mahayana Uttara Tantra Shastra, and then in the Tibetan language, Tekpa Chenpo Gyu Lame Denju, which in English is a composition to indicate a vast vehicle of the mind, the furthest everlasting stream.
Yes.
Names of sutras can be ascribed, or expositions on themes can be ascribed in many different ways. Here the name is ascribed in terms of the actual contents of the teaching, so the furthest everlasting stream indicates what the it was being discussed in the text, whereas other texts, like the 8,000-verse Prajnaparamita text, is given the name, its name in accordance to the number of verses within that text, whereas other texts, such as the Lankavatara, the that text is given its name in terms of the actual place where the text was delivered. And then there are other texts, such as the text requested by the maiden Ratna, in which the name is given in terms of the person who requested the teaching. So the to go through each word of the text, of the title of the text, it starts with the word tekpa, which is a vehicle of the mind. And a vehicle of the mind is something which goes somewhere, so it speaks in terms of both a path of mind that is going somewhere, and likewise a vehicle of mind that is the actual result attained. It is a vast vehicle of the mind, or Mahayana, from the point of view of having vast deep awareness, vast intention or heart, vast endeavors, and so forth. There are seven points from which it is vast, and primary among all of these is having a very vast intention. And based on having a vast intention, then there are vast actions that one engages in terms of it. The next word in the title is an everlasting stream, and an everlasting stream is a continuity, something which continues from past to from past moments to present and on to future moments. So it's a stream of continuity. And since it's a text which is explaining how to purify away the stains from the everlasting stream of one's own mind stream, then this is how it's to be understood in terms of it being the title. So it's a text which indicates the everlasting stream in terms of what one gets down to when one has purified away the various stains. And likewise, it is the furthest or later in terms of it's the later one, which has been taught after the second round of transmission of the preventive measures in terms of the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras. So it comes after that, and being after, then it's furthest. It goes beyond that. And since it is a based on the sutra of the essential factors for accordant progress, that's the Buddha Nature Sutra, and it is a composition to indicate what was meant in that sutra. Therefore, it's called a composition to indicate a vast vehicle of the mind, the furthest everlasting stream.
This one. That is one. Then,
then it starts, I prostrate to all the clear evolved and the spiritual heroes expanding their heart. This is the prostration made in the beginning by the translators. The prostration, or which is given in the beginning by the translators, follows a custom which was made in Tibet, which was that the according to which of the three baskets of teachings, the Tripitaka, that the text itself belonged to, then the prostration or salutation, salutary verse at the beginning was made in accordance with that. So here, the prostration is to the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas, the clear evolved and the expanding hearted ones, and that indicates that this text belongs to the basket of sutra teachings. The first verse gives the brief presentation of the contents of the text. Says to the clear evolved ones, preventive measures, community and the source, also purified growth, the qualities, and finally enlightening influence of the clear evolved. The body of all indicative compositions, when gathered in brief, is these 7 points that are diamond strong. So the text is presenting 7 diamond strong points. First, it's discussing the clear evolved ones, or Buddhas, then the preventive measures, or Dharma, the community, which is the Sangha, and then the source is referring to the Buddha nature. The Buddha nature, or the source of clear evolvement, is referring to the actual nature and so forth when it is covered with stains. In other words, at the time when the various stains which are obscuring these sources or essential factors have not been abandoned, have not been gotten rid of. Then the state in which they have been gotten rid of or purified away is called the state of purified growth or bodhi. This is referring to enlightenment. Then the next point are the qualities, which are corrections of inadequacy. And these are the qualities of that state of enlightenment, referring to the 32 qualities, which are qualities of being parted. And these are such as the qualities of the 10 powers of the mind and so forth. So these are parted qualities. And likewise, there are the 32 ripened qualities, such as the features of the enlightening body of a Buddha. Then the final point of the seven is the enlightening influence or Buddha activity of that state of enlightenment.
Mm-hmm.
As for how these seven diamond strong points, which are the contents of this text, are arranged into its five chapters, the first four of these, the points about the clear evolved ones, or the Buddhas, the preventive measures, or Dharma, the community, or Sangha, and the source, which is the Buddha nature, these four are presented in the first chapter, which deals with the source. And then the next point, the fifth, the state of purified growth of enlightenment, is presented in the second chapter. Then the qualities of that state are presented in the third chapter. The fourth chapter deals with the seventh of these points, the enlightening influence. And then the fifth chapter discusses the benefits or advantages of this text. Of all seven points which are discussed in this text, the root or most basic and fundamental point discussed is this point about the source or Buddha nature. The way that we can understand this is that this source, which are the essential factors allowing us to achieve enlightenment, allowing us to make accordant progress to that state, is something which is covered with various stains. It's something which needs to be purified. And so to reach the state in which all the stains are purified away from that, in other words, to reach the state of enlightenment or total purification and growth, we need to rely on the first three of these points, the Buddhas, the Dharma, and the Sangha, that is those who have already purified away the stains from their source, so that we ourselves then can achieve the fifth point, that state of purified growth ourselves. Then, on the basis of that, we'll have all the various enlightening qualities, which are corrections of inadequacy, based on having purified away the stains from the source within us, and then having achieved that state with all its qualities, then we'll be able to exert an enlightening influence on others in terms of being able to awaken the sources within them, which will allow them to purify away the stains from their sources as well.
That's 다 슝들 봐 카로 간 봐. 슝디들이야 카 간제. 카 간제. 즉 하시게 되셔야 되나?
So to complete the to fill out and complete the meaning of what is intended in this text, there are a few words which can be added.
다 나바 산제베 쳬기 닝든디 가사 닝든디 쳬바다 다와니체 쳬바 가르슬라노 사와메지버체 쳬바 가르슬라노 덴중부 다와체
The essence of the teachings of the Buddha are in terms of the behavior and the view or outlook, and the main point of the behavior, the conduct that one follows, is nonviolence, and the main point of the outlook or the view is in terms of dependent arising. When we look at the first of these, the point of the behavior in Buddhism, in terms of non-violence, when or not causing harm, then on the surface level, that's not to actually cause harm to any other being. But on a deeper level, not only is it referring to not causing any harm, but if possible, to be able to try to benefit or help others. And it's not necessary to go through various complicated lines of reasoning for this, but rather it's just on the basis of the fact that we wish to be happy and not to have any problems or suffering, and so does everyone else. So the ultimate point then of not causing, of wishing to be happy ourselves and wishing to get rid of suffering, and on the basis of that, following a course of nonviolence.
No. I think you see, because everyone wants happiness, do not want suffering. On that basis, nonviolence is, you see, the key point, right? Those check. That. Now, why, right? That reason,
so what is the reason for non-violence in order to bring about happiness and to eliminate suffering? And that is because of the view of dependent arising. So the happiness that we wish to achieve is something which is based on causes or reasons, and the suffering which we wish to get rid of is likewise something which arises because of causes. So both suffering or unhappiness and happiness, which we wish to achieve, both of these are based on causes and circumstances. Therefore, if we wish to achieve various results, we have to work in terms of dependent arising, in terms of their causes.
That thing you say in the Zane, Kasuri, Ran Rangi, Dewa the Tunis Yandi, Ran Rangi, do the games of the Chung Yinji, Jidin Kobo Messi.
So when we speak about the fact that happiness and suffering both come about merely because of their own specific causes and circumstances, this is the presentation that we have here in Buddhism of the creator of the world. There are various levels of understanding, subtle and rough, of dependent arising. One level of understanding it is in terms of the happiness that we wish to achieve and the unhappiness that we wish to get rid of, that all of these arise dependently on their respective causes and circumstances. And when you discuss this in a more extensive form, that would involve the 12 links of dependent arising.
That tether, any dujitch, dual attending, dujin a raleting, did they get a dujitch? Oh, can that say rarangi? Any duisha one lechon, that dui one lechon, mado, dula madova, rawango upon a duya medevichi. Chad, chad ever induzane? Daganda, can the two yundu, rawango upon a duya medevichi. That is the part of the statue of the time. Do you know what I'm saying? I'm saying that.
Another level of understanding it is in terms of when we speak about conditioned phenomenon or affected phenomenon. These are phenomenon which arise affected by or independence or dependent upon their own respective causes and circumstances. So in this sense, all affected or conditioned phenomenon arise dependently from causes and circumstances. Now this can be extended to cover those phenomenon which are unaffected by causes and circumstances or unconditioned phenomenon. Although they do not arise dependent upon causes and circumstances, nevertheless, their existence is something which does depend upon their own parts. It is something which does depend upon having such things as a basis for imputation or designation. And so these phenomena as well arise dependent on other things. So this level of understanding of dependent arising is in terms of both affected and unaffected phenomenon, or conditioned and unconditioned phenomenon. Both of these are things which depend on other things, that none of these are things which exist independently from their own side, independent of either causes and circumstances or independent of parts and bases for labeling.
Good
And so when we examine and see things, observe things with our own eyes, that things arise because of causes and circumstances, then this is something which convinces us that things do not arise under their own power. And so based on seeing the dependent arising of things, then we can understand the lack of things existing inherently, independently, from their own side, under their own power. So we look at the fact of things being dependent arising, arisings, that things arise dependent upon causes and circumstances, and based on that, that this is the foundation from which various effects, such as benefit and harm, come about, namely based on their various causes and circumstances. This is something which leads us to how dependent arising is something which is non-fallacious, that it always is the case in terms of benefit and harm comes from appropriate causes and circumstances. Now, when we are convinced of how this law of dependent arising, that things arise from causes and circumstances and so on, is something which is non-fallacious, which is never incorrect, which is never wrong, that naturally leads us to more conviction in the view that things lack inherent existence, that things lack or are void of existing inherently under their own power, independent of rising, dependently on causes and circumstances. So the two understandings, the one of dependent arising being non-fallacious, is something which supports or gives us more conviction in the fact that things arise, that things do not exist independently under their own power or inherently from their own side. And likewise, when we understand that things are devoid of existing inherently from their own side, that gives us more conviction in how do they exist. They exist in terms of being dependent arisings. So these are the two true facts. If we expand from the two truths, then we get the four truths, the four noble truths, in terms of true problems or sufferings and true causes for all of them. Because these are the first two truths, and this we can see is in terms of this whole idea of dependent arising, that since it is fitting and appropriate that things come about from causes and circumstances, therefore when we present what are true problems that face everyone or true sufferings, then these arise from their true causes for them. Then likewise, in terms of dependent arising, if we wish to achieve a true stopping or a true cessation of these sufferings, then it's necessary to follow a cause for that, or true paths of the mind. So the second two truths as well, the true facts of the path and the true stoppings or cessations, likewise follow in terms of this whole process of cause and effect or dependent arising. Now, these true cessations or true stoppings are something which can be established in terms of the presentation of voidness of inherent existence or the total absence of a true inherent existence. That's one side, but then it can also be explained in terms of the clear light nature of the mind. And this is what is presented or discussed in this text. It presents it from that point of view, because in this text it talks about how the stains which cover the mind, or the nature of the mind, are something which is fleeting, while the mind itself is something which is complete with all qualities. So on the basis of that, it establishes the true cessations or true stoppings of suffering. So the text is discussing then how to eliminate or get rid of or purify these various stains which are obscuring the nature of the mind in order to get to a state of true cessation or true stopping of them. And this is done in terms of applying various opponents. And so what is the actual opponent is going to be the application of true paths of the mind, the fourth truth, true paths. And this, as presented here in the text, would be then the preventive measures, or the dharma. These are the true paths of the mind. And by applying these true paths of the mind, these preventive measures, then one achieves a state in which there is a parting an absence of the things that we wanted to get rid of. You wanted to stop certain things, and that state in which what we wanted to stop is actually stopped, that state of being parted from these things that we wanted to get rid of is called a true stopping or a true cessation. It's the state in which we have gotten rid of what we wanted to get rid of. So this state in which we have achieved a true stopping, this true stopping is the actual dharma jewel, or the actual gem of preventive measures. And anyone who has such a state on their mind stream is would be an actual member of the community or sangha jewel.
Tati tadum da ni lam kumshin kumshin liya pangja pangi 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 chene lam ji tamba saba chi ke di de chang de go den saba chi ke yang lam den saba ke yang go den top do chene ya yad 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 chene be gyen pangi 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 chene tama kya tada lo ge pongji da ga so le ge lam thur du du mon du chene ani di tu ke ji ni ba lo pangja tada pang be chawa thobi du zane ran ju ne ji khasa de ani sanje gu jo le chi
And so anyone who has these type of true stoppings, who have gotten rid of these things to be gotten rid of on their mind stream, those are a member of the intent community or the Sangha. And so by gradually applying true paths of the mind, which bring about true stoppings, then we work in turn applying more paths of the mind and achieving more stoppings, getting rid of more and more things that we wish to get rid of, until ultimately we get rid of everything that needs to be gotten rid of, or we've abandoned everything to be abandoned. And then the second moment, once we have actually achieved that state, then someone who has gotten rid of everything to be gotten rid of is an actual Buddha, someone who is totally cleared out or clear-minded and fully evolved. So we need to be able to establish in this way then the three jewels of the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha based on the four truths. Now, when we take safe direction or refuge from these three gems or three jewels, the clear evolved ones, the Buddhas, the preventive measures, or the Dharma, and the intent community, or the Sangha, we can take safe direction, safe and sound direction from them in terms of their existence in the mind streams of others, other than us. And so when we look at Buddhas who are other than us, the Dharma jewels and the Sangha jewels in mind streams other than our own, and this is this will then act as a cause for us to actually go in that direction, in that safe direction of them. And so this is known as taking of safe direction in terms of the causes for them. Sources of direction taken from the cause, that act as a cause for us to attain them ourselves. So there are these sources of direction or safe direction which will act as a cause for us to attain them ourselves in terms of taking our direction from others, but then also there's the taking of direction or safe direction in terms of the future results which we ourselves wish to achieve. And so we look in terms of the attainment of the Dharma and the Sangha and the Buddha. In other words, the attainment that we ourselves will have in the future of these preventive measures, this jewel of preventive measures, the attainment that we ourselves will have in terms of being a member of this intent community, the ultimate attainment that we ourselves will have in the future of being a fully enlightened Buddha. And when we take our safe direction or refuge in terms of these attainments or results which we ourselves will achieve in the future, that's called a resultant refuge, or taking our direction from the future results that we ourselves will achieve. So there are these two types of taking of safe direction or taking of refuge. There's the taking of refuge in terms, or taking our source in the gems that exist in others, which act as a cause for us to achieve them ourselves. And then there's the taking of refuge in terms of the direction that we can derive from the results that we ourselves will attain on our own mind stream in the future.
I think 2 hours go like this. I think too long. Do you feel too long? All right. Originally 2 hours, then 15-20 minutes break. Then another about 2 hours. All right? All right. Ta rusi beni kasa. Oh, ta chosun gu nane, ra. Chosun gu nane, ini sanje de kyeop deumbo bosla bare. Ta gwade bu chae bae ina. Sanje de kyeop deumbo bu chae ni. Eumji de namba de dao yin chae bare. Namba gigen de dao. Ta namba de dao sleum de.
Now, when we speak of these three gems, these three sources of safe direction, the main one of these are the Buddhas, the clear evolved ones themselves, and they are likened to being like a doctor. Whereas the actual safe direction that we can derive is from the preventive measures or the Dharma itself. And that is similar to medicine. If we wish to be cured from a sickness, then the actual thing that we must rely on is to take medicine as some type of preventive measure, so to get rid of the disease. So likewise here, in terms of the whole process of getting rid of all our problems and all our sufferings altogether, likewise the thing that we need to take to get rid of it completely is the preventive measures themselves, the Dharma. So it is in this way that the Dharma, or the preventive measures, are things that will give us our actual source of direction, because they are the things which, like medicine, will actually cure us or help us to get rid of all our problems and suffering. So in this way, the Dharma are the preventive measures which, like medicine, will be the actual refuge, or the actual thing which will allow us to get rid of our problems. And the gem of the Sangha, this is the intent community, the community intent on this goal, are the helpers along this way, and so they are similar to nurses. Now, if we are going to take some medicine in order to get cured of some sickness or disease, it's necessary that we have relied beforehand on an actual competent doctor to have prescribed this medicine, a doctor who would have examined us correctly and would have prescribed the actual medicine which suits the sickness. So, and likewise, we need to rely also on nurses and others which are going to help us in the process of getting cured from our sickness. So in this way, the three gems are similar to that, because the Dharma is the preventive measures that we actually take to be cured of our problems. The Buddha, the clear evolved ones, are the ones that prescribe these preventive measures that we need to take, and the community of the Sangha are those who help us during the process of taking these preventive measures, or the Dharma, in order to get cured of all our problems.
Although
we are no longer living at present at the time when the Buddha Shakyamuni himself is present on this earth. We need to have some substitute who will act as a representative for the Buddha Shakyamuni, and so in this sense, it is important for us to have a spiritual teacher who will actually act as a substitute for the Buddha in prescribing these preventive measures. And so when we look at these preventive measures and so forth, the Dharma, these are things which others have taken and have achieved their attainment by means of them in terms of the Buddhas themselves. And so we ourselves need to do the same as they have done, and likewise take these preventive measures ourselves and work on our minds in order to actually cure ourselves and get rid of all our problems. And so when we take safe direction in terms of following these preventive measures, we do this all the way to our attainment of enlightenment. So if we describe or explain what actually this word dharma means in an easy to understand way. If we try to understand what these preventive measures or dharma is talking about, it perhaps will be a little bit easier to understand in terms of the whole process of ridding ourselves of various faults or mistakes. As I mentioned the other day, that someone who follows the Dharma, someone who takes these preventive measures, is someone who is working with strong effort and energy to try to overcome the various faults on their own mind streams. And so within these preventive measures, there are both offensive and defensive measures that can be taken. So first we'll discuss the defensive measures. The thing that we first have to do is to identify who or what is the adversary that we want to overcome, and the adversary that we want to overcome, or the enemy, is the disturbing attitudes or klesha. So what are these examples of some of these disturbing attitudes? They would be pride, infatuated attachment, jealousy, and so on. Anger. These are our enemies. And before we can actually strike out offensively at them to get rid of them, first we have to set up a line of defense within ourselves. And what is that referring to? That's referring to ethical self-discipline. And so even though we might have these disturbing attitudes present in our minds, nevertheless, we have to prevent them from spilling over into the actual actions of our body or our speech. And so we have to be able to hold our own or stand strongly ourselves in terms of restraining or keeping back from having these disturbing attitudes causing to have ourselves not let these disturbing attitudes cause us to act or to speak in a disturbing manner. So this refers to the refraining from the 10 destructive actions or non-virtuous actions, and this is the basic foundation, and all of you are undoubtedly aware of this. Once we can hold our own against the disturbing attitudes so that we don't come under their power, that they cause us to act or to speak in a destructive manner, once we can hold our own against them in terms of having ethical self-discipline, then we are in a position in which we can now launch the offensive attack against them. And the way that we launch this offensive attack is in terms of using the methods of, first of all, gaining a serenely stilled and settled state of mind, that's shine or shamatha, in which we can concentrate totally in complete absorption and concentration. Then, once we have this serenely stilled and settled state of mind, then we can develop an exceptionally perceptive state of mind, or vipassana, or thlatong in Tibetan, in which we have this exceptionally perceptive awareness of reality, of voidness. And so in this combined state in which our mind is both serenely stilled and exceptionally perceptive, we'll be able to actually have all the proper offensive weapons to be able to get rid of these disturbing attitudes and the problems that they cause us. There are temporary opponent forces that we can employ in this battle, and so temporarily, as an opponent against anger, we can apply love and tolerance. And as an opponent to our infatuated attachment, we meditate or build up the habit of seeing things in terms of their ugliness to overcome our infatuation with which we become very attached to them. We likewise think in terms of how things are impermanent, that nothing remains static, that nothing has a true identity, that all things involve problems and suffering and so forth, and this helps us to overcome our infatuations and attachments.
Certain subject which you want to know. Meantime, very difficult, very complicated.
So to overcome one's pride and arrogance, you think about various subjects or topics which you want to know but which you do not yet know, and in this way, this lessens your pride of feeling that you know everything already. As an opponent to having a great deal of mental wandering, which our mind wanders all over the place. And as for an opponent to jealousy, if we meditate on rejoicing in the happiness of others, that will act as an opponent to jealousy. Like this, we have various temporary opponent forces that we can apply. But to get to the deepest offensive weapon that we want to use, we need to see that all these various disturbing attitudes that we have come about because of our grasping for things to exist in a true and unimputed manner. So this grasping for true existence is what is the root causing all our various disturbing attitudes. And so the really deepest type of offensive weapon that we need to apply is the understanding of reality with which we will overcome our grasping for things to exist in a true manner, which they do not do.
Weapon digging in a fuel cell, what's on a saddle?
Fuel?
And as for what the fuel is, as for what the fuel is for these offensive weapons, it's the positive potential or merit that we've built up from positive actions.
And if fuel, you may not position side it.
If you don't have very much fuel in your rocket, then the rocket is going to fall down very quickly. So since we want our offensive weapons to be able to travel very far, then we need to have a great deal of fuel in terms of a great store of positive potential or merit. And what is the root for building up this positive potentials? The root of it all is our motivation. If the motivation is just to attain liberation or freedom from our problems ourselves, then the fuel will only have that much potency or ability to go that far. Whereas if our motivation is to achieve the full enlightened state of a Buddha, to become totally clear-minded and fully evolved ourselves, in order to be able to benefit infinite limited beings, then our fuel is going to have that much more power. It will have that power which is infinite, similar to the motivation being so infinite. As it says in the precious garland, if we were to try to count all the limited beings, they are without number, they're immeasurable. And so if we aim our motivation towards these immeasurable, innumerable limited beings, beings with limited awareness or sentient beings, and have the wish to be able to help them, then the qualities and benefits that we will achieve from this motivation will be in accordance with its aim being so infinite. So it itself will be infinite.
Lomas again, she was a chicken, you saw she was chained, that she did Lomas Sadu, yes, and 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 Lomas 다 디처메 싱 타다 아슬럽인데 싱 메르 머르 루율 마셔나야 대 탐자 로게 로마데 집이 주니 인데 버치 고도고도 집이 시련이 버치 고도고도가 와다 셈제 메르 머르 루율도 마셔나야 대원도지 동해 민도 셈제지 인 천재나 다 대 탐자 로 인데 동해를 잡아지다 대화도 대바지 주로 자나 아 삼백 로지 옵트칼 수 뒤투도가 신소에 그다 라로지 챔도 자니
As far as developing an altruistic motivation towards all sentient beings, there is no need between identifying each and every sentient being individually, but just consider that all, everything which desire happiness and desire to avoid suffering is a sentient being. Therefore, each and everything which possesses such quality is a sentient being, and I will work for just everything which possesses such quality. If I may, if we give an example, if we say that all the leaves of the trees will fall in the due time, we don't need to identify each and every leaf. We might give an example and say that in the same way that the leaves of this and that tree fell at a certain time, in due time, all the leaves of all the trees will fall. So in the same way, when our motivation turns itself towards all sentient beings, there's a need to identify each and every sentient being individually, but just it's turning oneself to what or whoever it is which wants suffering, wants to avoid suffering and to achieve happiness.
That D, Tedder, any Kadaji Parker Chitantla, rather, offensive, that offensive Chiadigi, Numu, that interview, Tashi Sundigitone, Numu Jomia, Numu Jomia di Parker Chicche, Numu Jomsare, Parker, Numu Jomia di Bodu, Ribut Chicche, that's one stage. Another stage, the Kareslam, that Numu Ti Shagwe Paja, Ra, Numu Ti Shagwe Paja. 더도 셰자 셰바나 파도 쥐어버 셰겐기 드버직 셰기도 와. 어, 다 드버디 다 쏘나고 쏘 타예베 좌도 셰베 관해. 애니 돈이도 왜 신라송 저기 땡인지 무튼 고민인데 애니 림베 림베기 딘데기 니나 추베 드마디 장요 이 말이.
So in this offense that we are taking.
어, 당연히 디슬다. 뇽몬디 좀 사서나 디미는 타바 타바 쓰게 하랬다. 그래봐. 뇽몬베 칭월에 좌와래.
When we've actually rid ourselves of all the disturbing attitudes, then we achieve what's known as a state of liberation. But this is just the first step in the offensive assault that we are taking. The first step is to get rid of our disturbing attitudes by applying method and wisdom. But once we've gotten rid of these disturbing attitudes and achieved a state of liberation, still, there are the various potentials of these disturbing attitudes which are still present on the mind stream, and these are acting as something which prevent us from being able to be omniscient, to be able to know all things that can be known. And so it's necessary to apply a second stage offense against these potentials as well by continuing to over and over again meditate and build up further and further as a beneficial habit the wisdom or understanding with which we realize voidness or a lack of true existence. And by doing that, then we'll be able to overcome all these potentials of these disturbing attitudes, all these mental obscurations, which cause things to appear in a discordant manner and thus prevent us from being able to know everything.
Any
And so we need to follow an offensive method then, which is one which is combining method and wisdom, one which is a combination of a serenely stilled and an exceptionally perceptive state of mind. We're following a path in which method and wisdom are combined in the sense that method is held within the context of wisdom, and wisdom is maintained within the context of method, and to follow such a path is the type of path that's presented in general Mahayana, according to the sutras.
Ah, yeah. Ta, tabshi sungri chedande, tele sandushin, ta, tabshi mo soso, chigrosu, chigson, tabu mahimba, lo ching ni, ane, kasur kuge, lo ching ni, dokche. And it taps his social jama mado, no logic to do dengeji. Then they get tapsing more, yer michibe, najote, nga lami, nga lamis nga nga subjeshadi.
However, if we try to go more deep and to a more
nga jita, hakbar nga lami subjeshadi, listen to me.
If we try to go to a more profound level of combining method and wisdom, then we don't just have a situation in which method is held within the context of wisdom and wisdom is held within the context of method, but rather what we want to do is to get the two of them together in one package. In other words, have the two be of one nature, which means that the two come together in one package, namely in one and the same mind. And although they might have that, although they still would have different names which can be ascribed to them, nevertheless, from the point of them being together in one mind, they are combined in one package in this way. So, this is
the
So, if we use an example, I am a monk, I am also a Tibetan, I am also the Dalai Lama. All of these are different names which can be ascribed, however they're referring to the same package, to the same thing. And so this is what was referred to by things being together in one package, but there can be many different names ascribed, and so there are the differences in terms of the different names. But basically they are together in one package, so when we have method and wisdom together as one package in terms of one mind, then that is the actual method which is in entered into in Tantra, and specifically in the highest level of Tantra, Anuttara Yoga. And when we have method and wisdom together in one package like this, as in Tantra, then this acts as weapon which will allow us to get rid of the stains or the things that we're trying to get rid of much more quickly. It's something which has a great deal more power. And when we overcome these most subtle types of mental obscurations, the ones preventing us from being omniscient, from knowing all things, then we achieve the omniscient state of a Buddha, in which we've gotten rid of all the things that we need to rid ourselves of.
Break.
So now we'll have a 15-minute break.
Did they collect the questions?